thanks for joining us, Jolanda.
Welcome.
So a lot of the research and a lot of the time when people talk about stereotyping and prejudice, people tend to focus on the perceiver or the person actually doing the stereotyping and holding the negative beliefs.
Yeah.
But there's another person involved or another group of people involved, which is the targets who are being stereotyped and you know, seen differently and treated differently. What effects do stereotypes have on the targets of stereotyping?
Yes, good question. There's now quite a bit of work that shows that if you belong to a stigmatized group, right, group that is being stereotyped, that faces discrimination on the basis of your group membership in that particular group, that we do see that that can have tremendous negative effects for your physical and also mental well-being. And the effects are there in terms of, you know, that you find in sort of physical well-being, that belonging to a stigmatized group is associated with greater likelihood of heart conditions, diabetes, but also engaging in unhealthy health behaviors such as smoking, excessive drinking, etc. So we do know that it has negative effects for physical well-being, but also negative effects for mental well-being. So in a sense that members of stigmatized groups are more likely to be depressed, have anxiety disorders, etc. And we do see these negative physical and mental health effects. We find them among a range of different groups, that face stigma or stereotyping on the basis of their race, their gender, their sexual orientation, and lots of other things.
So a lot of these groups are groups that you're born into, you know, or you don't have a lot of choice in belonging to. But there are some negatively stigmatized groups that people actually choose to belong to.
Yeah.
Why would somebody choose to, what do they get out of a negatively stigmatized group? Like, why would you choose to do that?
Well, that is interesting. That's a question we asked ourselves too, and we did quite a bit of research, for instance, among people who choose to have body piercings in their face and who actually experience discrimination as a result of that. So they may not be hired for particular jobs because managers may object to hiring someone as a waiter who has many visible piercings. So we were exactly interested in that issue. Why would people do this when they can actually face negative evaluations on the basis of, you know, expressing their identity in a particular way? And we did find it interesting that at times people do also say, yes, I get these negative responses of that because of that, but precisely because this helps me to express who I am, where I belong, and who are other people that actually sort of that I affiliate with. So they actually sense and build a sense of identity around that particular stigma. And interestingly then, the more that people face discrimination on the basis of that belonging to that particular group, the more likely that it is that they want to stay in that group, the more likely is it that they want to get, for instance, more body piercings.
So it almost becomes like, it makes you even more distinct, and it feels like you're in a club or, you know, a very hard to get into club perhaps. There's a high cost of entry.
Yes. So it looks as if, yes, of course we want to avoid negative responses, but in this particular case, the negative responses also affirm that, yes, I have recognised who I am and I'm proud of who I am. I turn that negative response into something that helps me to establish a particular identity and a belonging to a particular group.